The Book of the Dervishes. If you know not these states, pass on, nor join the infidel in ignorant counterfeit, but all learn not the secrets of the way. Shabastari, Secret Garden, Johnson Pasha's version. If there is any standard dervish textbook, it is the Gifts of Deep Knowledge, the Arawif el-Marif, written in the 13th century and studied by members of all orders. Its author, Sheikh Shahabuddin Surawadi, 1145 to circa 1235, presided over the coalescing of theory, ritual and practice which took place in his time, established teaching schools close to the courts of Persia and India, and was chief of the chiefs of Sufis in Baghdad. The book is of interest to us both because it shows the outward and early stages of attraction into the dervish corpus, because it contains the basic contents of thought and action of these mystics, and because of Lieutenant Colonel Wilberforce Clark. Colonel Clark was himself a dervish, probably of the Surawadi order. He translated more than half of the Gifts for the first time into English and published it in 1891. Also, the first English translator of Saadi's Orchard, Nizami's Story of Alexander, and Hafiz's works, he was a worthy follower of the tradition of distinguished Sufic adapters such as Raymond Lully. Taken as a whole, Clark's work can be seen as an attempt to present dervish thinking to an English audience, which was thinking of the dervish as an insane, blood-stained fanatic. Dervishes there were in the Sudan. They were taken to be some kind of savage. Others were known in Turkey, but Turkey was rather beyond the pale, of course. Clark brought the original text more up to date, with quotations from Sir William Jones, Malcolm, The Secret Garden of Shabastari, Brown's Dervishes, and other available material. He pointed out that the great Hafiz had been mistranslated and misunderstood by the poet Emerson and others. He did not shrink from printing parallel extracts showing mistranslation to the advantage of the dervish, not for his own academic reputation. Clark attains a great deal of lucidity by rearranging the materials with which he is working in such a way as to reflect, with added information to make the picture intelligible to the English reader, the working of Sufism as a semi-organized activity within the religious context of Islam. It is difficult to see how this could have been better done, given the prevailing need in Britain for religious matters to be presented in a way analogous to the current brand of Protestant practice. This book is now nearly impossible to obtain. Islam, he noted, forbids monasticism. The people who were later known as dervishes took, in the year 623, an oath of fraternity and fidelity in Arabia. They chose the name of Sufi, which stands for wool, suf, pious, Sufi, and other meanings. These were the nucleus of the Muslim Sufis, the original 45 contracting individuals of Mecca, together with an equal number from Medina. The practice of these people was given expression in various ways. The first caliph and the fourth, Abu Bakr and Ali, formed special assemblies at which exercises were held. These schools were paralleled by Uwais, the founder of the first austere order in 657. Buildings were first dedicated to the movement's use in Syria in the 8th Christian century, thus far the overt expressions of Islamic Sufism. The parallel Sufic law which sees Sufism as a continuum, Clark records, uses the wine allegory to show the gradual development of the teaching until it became a more or less public manifestation, before retreating again within itself in the 17th century. This is expressed thus. The seed of Sufism was sown in the time of Adam, germed in the time of Noah, budded in the time of Abraham, began to develop in the time of Moses, reached maturity in the time of Jesus, produced pure wine in the time of Muhammad. Quoting attacks made on Sufis for voluptuous libertinism and for being derived from external systems, the kernel affirms its essential unity and individuality. It is not, he says, introduced from Greece or India. He explains the meaning of the dervish claim, "Neither fear we hell, nor desire we heaven," which sounds so strange from the mouth of one whom every external assessment identifies as a religious man. He is well aware of the Sufi experience that at every stage of development a new mystery or change in perception and understanding is involved. Traces of Sufi doctrine, he says, very bravely for his time, exist in every country, in the theories of ancient Greece, in the modern philosophies of Europe, in the dream of the ignorant and of the learned, in the shade of ease and the hardship of the desert. But enlightenment can come only through the rarest of all men, no matter how frequent a patchy illusion of truth may break through the seeker's confusion. This teacher is the perfect and excellent guide. When he exists, to discover him is impossible. The teacher discovers the disciple, not the other way about. False teachers and deceived seekers vainly pursue the desert vapour, and wearied return the dupe of their own imagination. The problem of the would-be Sufi is in recognizing his teacher, because he is not yet sufficiently refined to know who he may be. Perfection, who shall discover save he who is perfect? The jewel's price, who shall tell save the jeweler? Hence the disarray into which some repetitious dervish systems have fallen, as have other bodies of doctrine. Clark quotes Muhammad, "By pious fools my back hath been broken." The desire of the teacher is that the real desire of the disciple be fulfilled, that his base qualities be transmuted into laudable ones, that understanding come to him. Because it is necessary to use certain methods of overcoming undesirable mental states, the dervish described by Clark must never shun temptation in the sense of fleeing from evil just to avoid it. He uses the externals of religion and seeks to soak himself in its lore as an insurance against losing his way. At the same time, he knows that paradise, hell, all the dogmas of religion are allegories, the spirit whereof he alone knows. This he terms the creed of the men of heart, the inward people. Evil for them exists only as not being. Being itself, if attained completely, removes the possibility of the negation, so-called evil. By divine illumination, man sees the world to be illusion, in the sense that there is a greater reality of which the world is a gross distortion, and hence he calls the world evil. He tries to shake off not being, in the Sufi phrase used by Clark. It is not possible to understand Sufi poetry unless one is steeped in the imagery and almost unbelievable depth of feeling, which is cloaked in allegory. Clark's book now gives some of the technical terms which have been explained in The Secret Garden for the guidance of the would-be seeker, cleverly selecting points which would be most difficult for Western readers. Clark explains the use of the wine allegory. Ecstasy and rapture, for instance, are not the states necessarily referred to when drunkenness is mentioned by Sufis. Because the intellect is dulled by alcohol, the Sufi state, hostile to superficial logic, is seen as a development consequent upon the paralysis of what most people regard as thought. To the Sufi, the automatic thought processes, the associative functions, are useful only in the fields in which they work, scholasticism, mechanical thinking. The self-righteousness, which was such a marked feature of much Victorian thinking, is a target for Clark, and he selects Sufic matter whose emphases would be meaningful in his time. This concentration upon self, or what one assumes to be oneself, is the veil of light. The veil of darkness is the state of mind of the evil man who knows he is evil. Freed from this kind of self is the tavern haunter, the dervish. He is neither a believer nor an infidel, in any of the meanings of the word perceptible to the intellect or familiar emotion. This admirable recension of essential parts of the gifts begins in substance with the character of the sheikh, the guide of the dervish. As far as the disciple is concerned, his first real step in his new life is the finding of such a person. The function of this director is to remove the rust, in the Sufi phrase, from the mind, so that eternal, objective fact may be accessible to him. In a manner which adequately anticipates modern psychology, the Gifts early stresses the need for the guide to be free from subjective reasons for seeking leadership. He must not seek precedence, being a guide, or have a desire to be followed. The true leader will delay accepting applicants as disciples until he is sure that he has no such subjectivity. The guide must be able to determine the capacity of the disciple. He will have to deal with this disciple in accordance with his potentiality. If there is little promise, he will have to use severe methods, such as admonishment. He orders him to follow certain attitudes of mind in order to change his unbalanced concentration upon certain things. Unless he has this perception, the sheikh cannot be a guide at all. The guide must have no desire for, nor part in, any of the property of the disciple. He can only accept material things from a disciple when he is impelled to use them for the common good. When a disciple wants to bestow his property on the sheikh, the dervish teacher may take it, because he is able to exchange it for the tranquility which the disciple needs. But if the disciple is still attached to property, he will be allowed to spend some. The encouragement of the sincerity of the disciple is one of the major concerns of the sheikh, as also the severing of undesirable attachments of mind. An important part of this activity is charity and distribution of material substance. The disciple should choose poverty rather than riches, though to the Sufi, poverty and riches are as one. The sheikh has to extend kindness and compassion. He abridges the austerities of the disciple as far as is possible within the needs of the work. Too strong privations may prevent the disciple from integrating himself with the dervish effort at first. The effect upon the disciple of what the sheikh says is a most important one. It is likened to a seed, and only from good seed can a good crop be raised. Pollution in the mind of the learner can stem from the sheikh having a desire to influence the hearer, or any pride in himself. The sheikh does not talk to a disciple without an objective reason. Objective speech is when it means the same to the speaker as to the hearer. Advice is given to disciples in a disguised or allegorical form, especially when it is a criticism. The inner development of the disciple is something which the guide keeps secret. Expectation of developments on the part of the former is undesirable, and the sheikh will explain that anticipation of certain states of mind will close the road to them. The disciple must honour the sheikh deeply. Therein lies his hope. But conversely, the sheikh must not expect to be honoured by the disciple. The rights of the disciple are always respected by the sheikh. The teaching sheikh does not spend much of his time in association with the community. He allots times for retirements and movements, kilwat and jilwat. The teacher has his own special exercises. These are personal, for himself and others, and for devotion to the activity. He has to practice detachment from people as such. He also engages in special acts of devotion and benevolence in various forms, including religious ones. Clark now places the section dealing with the duties of the disciple or learner, the directed one, after the functions of the sheikh, in variation from the original version. The first important point stressed is the necessity of the teacher to the disciple. The teacher's acceptance is the nearest thing to divine acceptance, and represents it as far as it can. The disciple's right to sheikhly guidance is in part gained by a correct attitude towards his teacher. The sheikh has this right of being honoured. The disciple observes 15 rules of conduct. He must repose complete faith in his guide in instructing, directing, and purifying disciples. He must attend the teacher carefully and closely. He is obedient to the sheikh. He abandons opposition outwardly and inwardly. He accords his will with the will of the director. He observes the thoughts of the sheikh. He refers his dreams to the sheikh for diagnosis of his thoughts. He is expectant of the words of the teacher. He lowers his voice before the sheikh. He does not allow his selfishness to extend at large. He addresses his teacher as O Sayyid, Prince, or O Maula, Master. He addresses his teacher with observance of the convenience of the time. He must not speak of stages of mind and experience which are not his own, neither must he speak much to the teacher of his own stage. He must conceal the miracles of the teacher of which he may learn. He must reveal to the sheikh his own experiences. He speaks to the sheikh in a manner which the sheikh will understand. Having arrived at the stage when the conventions of a dervish community may be studied, Colonel Clark now summarizes Surawadi's fifth item in his own third section. When the dervish arrives at the convent, he tries to make it before the afternoon. He salutes the spot in prayer and then shakes hands with those present. An offering, probably of food, is made to the dwellers. Dervishes are divided into two sections, dwellers and travellers. Dervishhood itself is often considered to be a certain condition or phase of being a Sufi, not invariably a vocation or permanent state. In this sense, it cannot be compared with the monastic organization of, say, Christianity or Buddhism. The dervish may stay 3 days at a convent as a guest. After this, he can stay if he can find some employment within the precincts which will occupy him correctly. Those who are engaged in a phase of continuous devotion do not perform physical service about the convent. There are 3 stages or conditions of dervishes to be found in the community considered dwellers. The first group, at the earliest stage, are the people of service, al-ihidmat. They serve the regular dwellers and are at the earliest stage. They are at a stage before they can be given inner exercises and can only carry out external ones, coupled with inner intentions, which are not really developmental processes, though the servers may take them as such. Only by service do they become actually worthy of the degree of real service. The people of society, al-isubat, are often the younger ones, who spend time in sitting in house assemblies and carrying out mutual activities designed to provide the bond of knowledge, which reveals their reality and capabilities for the work. The people of retirement, al-ihilwat, are generally the senior people, who spend much time in solitude, conforming to the exercises which are proper to their stage. It is often the case that such an assembly of dervishes has no teacher among them. If this is the case, they are handicapped. They are able only to prepare themselves for the association of a master. They cultivate trust and patience and contemplation. They must eat together, so that they be associated outwardly as well as inwardly. They have to strive at all times to be not only in agreement with each other, but also in a state of complete equality, one with the other. No hierarchical organization or leadership is possible to them. Travel, both physically and metaphorically, can be an important part of dervish activity. The dervish travels in his own land, internally, and also through the countryside and from land to land, externally. Some sheikhs spend no more than 40 days in one place. On dead skins, by tanning, the effects of purity, of softness, and of delicacy of texture appear. Even so, by the tanning of travel, and by the departure of natural corruption and innate roughness, appears the purifying softness of devotion and change from obstinacy to faith. Yet dervishes may not travel at all. Those who have no teacher sometimes travel almost permanently. There are detailed programs for travel and the way in which its experience is utilized by the dervish. These are generally known as the 12 rules of travel. The dance of the dervishes, the subject of so much misinterpretation, is divided into audition and movement. The real dervish is not a musician, in the sense that he does not actually play instruments. Outside musicians or servers may do so. The Islamic authorities, outward sages, deny the permissibility of these activities. But they are permitted and encouraged in special circumstances and in accordance with needs by dervish saints and spiritual directors. There are grave disadvantages, amounting to complete negation of the work, inherent in the use of music and movement without an inner perception of what these are. Especially deleterious is any movement made during the audition of music, contrary to the custom when hearing music in a more lay situation, when movement is expected. The mantle, kirka, has a great deal of symbolical importance to the dervish. He sews his own cloak, generally made up of patchwork pieces. The bestowing of the mantle is a mark of passing impalpable blessing or power, or baraka, from one person to another. The succession of teacherhood is referred to as the inheritance of the mantle. The dervishes, in addition to much other lore, refer to the investiture by Muhammad of the mother of Khalid with a mantle that nobody else wanted. It was a small black cloak with yellow and red stripes of the Bedouin sort. The Sufi mantle is dark blue or white. The selection of a deputy is marked thus. When the sheikh seeth in the disciple the effects of holiness and the marks of acquisition to the degree of excellence and instruction, and wisheth to appoint him his own successor, he clotheth him with the robe of holiness and with the honour of his own favour, whereby may be effected the perpetuating of his order and the obeying of the people. Amid much else, the tradition about robes divides dervishes into three classes. The first take the mantle which the sheikh allots for their use. The second have no special garb because they are in a working condition. The last choose their own garb because their choice has become an absolute, necessary, complete, objective choice. The remainder of the material presented by Clark is best considered theoretical mixed with initiatory doctrine. The complexity is increased by the fact that many of the stages and experiences are conditional upon several factors. Sufism not being a static or simple proceeding, trying to freeze any stage can cause serious generalization and consequent distortion. For this reason, the material is to be seen as primarily illustrative, yet not without internal motion. Knowledge is represented in the Dervish Codex, as in current and ancient usage, as knowledge in general. The divisions of knowledge and its gradation are the subject of important Sufi work, because each stage in the journey is characterized by its appropriate knowledge. The general assumption that knowledge can be divided into two sorts, information and experience, is not accepted by Sufis. There are two forms, for instance, of akal, intelligence, the intelligence of the ordinary man, and that of the religious one. The first is fit for this world and its affairs, the latter for the next world. This is characterized by guidance, sometimes referred to as illumination. Then there is ordinary knowledge, contrasted with inner or deep knowledge. The first may be characterized by piety, the latter by perception of the workings of a divine activity. There is another form of knowledge, that of the theologist, which deals in such things as commands and prohibitions. These knowledges are pursued by three kinds of sages. The first is the sage of God, who has the three knowledges. The second kind of sage is he who contains the wisdom of the next world. The third path is that of the sage of this world. He knows only the outward forms of devotion. The real knowledge is a kind of nutrition, like food. Deep knowledge, marifat, is characterized by three subordinate forms of knowledge. The first is the wisdom of how each word or agent acts. The second is the recognition of each agent in the work. The third is the recognition of the agent through thought. The man who recognizes instantaneously the meanings of happenings and actions, without ordinary reflection, is the arif, the wise, the arrived Sufi, or the mature one. There are forms of understanding and re-understanding knowledge. These are described as the science of inner wisdom, the wisdom of science, the science of the wisdom of wisdom. These are the simplest terms in which the succession of refinements of knowledge and wisdom can be rendered. The so-called mystical state, hal, and its relationship with the stage of the traveller, is the subject of the next section dealt with by Clark. The mystical experience, which in other systems is considered to be the be-all and end-all of the quest, is for the dervish nothing more than a prelude to the attainment of true association with objective reality. The way in which it is received and in which an interaction between it and the receptor takes place will determine whether it is producing a valid progress. This is a most important consideration because it sharply divides Sufism from all other so-called mysticisms, whether induced by drugs or any other excitogenic cause. Stage, makam, is the degree of permanent knowledge of truth, objectivity, which has been attained. Ecstasy, therefore, is, or can be, the instrument for the establishment of makam. The hal is a gift, the makam is an acquisition. And the mystical state, according to the sheikhs of Khorasan, is the heritage of deeds, like lightning it appeareth and effaced becometh. Its manifestation is followed by concealment. It is transmuted, or transmutes the consciousness, providing contentment, riza. It is necessary to beware of the idea of progression or chronological development in these states, and Junaid has warned against this. He says, "From one hal one may advance to a higher one. From there he gains information wherewith he can amend his first state." There is a ratification of each state, which makes possible advance to another, and also makes possible the permanency of progress, of stage. Without a certain methodology, state, hal, is sporadic and repetitious, useless. The Dervish conception of the nature of God is now given, although it appears in the original almost at the beginning of the textbook. The Sufi does not worship anything but God, the unique one. At the same time, the nature of God as understood by the Sufi is not susceptible to enunciation in the crude words which serve for other purposes. God's abode, for instance, is not where God is. The answer to the question is He. He is in the time of He. He made things resemble and suffice by means of He. There is no possibility of arguing the existence or place of God, because God is not susceptible to the criteria which are available. This knowledge is the product of what is called certitude, yakina, which has a modus operandi of its own, not an intellectual one. Therefore, Sufism has its own science whereby it approaches the question. This science relies upon practice, not speculation. Dealing with matters which are generally termed of the next world, the book stresses the dangers of assumption that this form of being will be something which we can conceive within the coarse perceptions which we habitually employ for crude measurement. Attempts to reason out the relationship between the familiar and the concept of the next world will end in loss. When reason passes beyond its own limits, error results. Similarly, there is a limit to the efficient working of imagination and fancy. The imaginary picture evoked by the name of a person not so far seen may or may not approximate the reality. Two main forces are used by those who have no insight to combat those who have. The first force is that of the men of power who kill, punish, and harm. The second is that of the people of learning who use deceit, hypocrisy, and heresy. Steadiness is a technical term which is associated with remaining steadfast, conscious of the presence of God, considering that God is watching. This causes awareness of oneself and what one is and what one is doing. In this condition, the worshipper maintains an outward and inward adornment of rules. The inward knowledge on the basis of which this is done is called contemplation, watching, murakiba. Those who are in this stage say, yesterday is dead, tomorrow is not born, today is in the agonies of death. Those concentrating upon exercises connected with the past or the future are in a state of destruction. The safety and the salvation of the people is in their being engaged in the ordinance of the time. One of the specialist Sufic sciences is called the science of state, ilm ihal. The usage of this science varies in accordance with the capacities of the practitioners. There is no Sufi science greater than this, because it is the methodology whereby the gradations of hal are observed and applied. The science involves the interaction of states of mind and their relation to the physical happenings in the surroundings. The science of certainty is the revelation of truth, objective reality, through special states by experience, not by cerebration as we understand it in the conventional world. There are three phases of the science, practice and perception, of certainty, allegorized by calling the sun objectivity. The first, seeking guidance from the splendor and understanding of the heat of the sun. The second, by actually seeing the body of the sun. The third, the dispersing of the eye's light in the light of the sun itself. There are three stages of certainty, then, which Surawadi summarizes as the knowledge of certitude, in which it is known, verified, and evident, the essence of certainty, manifest and witnessed, the truth, reality of certainty, a double way in which there is a conjoining of the witnesser and witnessed. Beyond this point, words do not suffice, and the dervish is accused of pantheism and more. An attempt at explaining produces the word sequence The seer becometh the eye the seer. A distortion of meaning originating from the attempt to enunciate the process in formal terms is perpetuated by the reader, who cannot penetrate by the unaided intellect the real significance of the phrase. The doctrine of essence and its connection with the personality and the self is a most important part of Dervish study. There are, for illustrative purposes, two kinds of essence. The first is the essence of a thing, which is the inner essence, dat, and the truth, hakikat, of that thing. Truth here means objective reality, the inner meaning. People normally see or perceive only the outward use of a thing, are ignorant of any ultimate function of that thing. A lamp, for example, gives light. It may be used for heating or for decoration, but other functions of its true reality are imperceptible to the ordinary man. If, by a stretch of imagination, it were found through delicate scientific measurement that the lamp was giving off certain communication rays, this activity might be the expression of the true reality or essence of that lamp. Then there is the human essence, called the rational essence, the human spirit, which is known as the luminosity. This is the sum total of the grace, or baraka, impalpable qualities, of the individual. The perceiving of the operation and being of these elements is an extremely sensitive one. True inner knowledge of the essence is hinted at in the religious life. Hence, hints as to the knowledge of essence are found in the links and conditions of the knowledge of God. This assertion shows how all Dervish teaching is based not on the concept of God, but on the concept of essence. There is a slogan which summarizes this, and which clearly establishes that the religious context of Dervish thinking is merely the vehicle for the self-realization, which is aimed at "He who knows his essential self knows his God." Knowledge of the essential self is the first step, before which there is no real knowledge of religion. Sufis are accused of paganism because they first apply themselves to this problem, retaining the religious context as a practical working shape, rather than as any indication of final and objective truth. The means of appreciating the various stages and conditions of the essence and its progressive refinement are themselves an essential part of Dervish activity. It is here that the Dervish parts company with the mere theoretician. The latter says, "I will think this out." The Dervish, "I will prepare myself to perceive this, without using limited, obstructive thought, a childish process." The veiling, or interruption, of the correct use of the human spirit, or essence, is caused by an unbalanced indulgence in certain coarse sentiments, which together constitute a pattern of imprisonment, conditioning, characteristic of most people. These veils, or blamable qualities, are listed as 10. 1. Desire. Desires based on ignorance of what should be and on assumptions as to what is good for the individual. Austerity, correctly used, is the antidote to irrational desire. This is the stage of "I want a lollipop." 2. Separation. This is a type of hypocrisy, when the person uses rationalization to justify thoughts and actions which are centered upon himself, not upon an ultimate reality. The antidote is the practice of sincerity. 3. Hypocrisy. Characterized by self-pride, glorying in possessions, pseudo-independence, violence. This is overcome only by the practice of qualities which are reprehensible in the eyes of the people, but laudable in God's sight. They include submission of the right kind, humility, and the poverty of the fakir. These qualities are recognized only by correct assessment of the true worth of their opposites. 4. desire for praise and love. Narcissism, which precludes objective assessment of oneself, lack of a balancing factor which amounts almost to self-contempt. 5. Illusions of almost divine importance, countered only by the glory of the qualities of God. 6. Avarice and parsimony give rise to envy, the worst of all characteristics. This can be dissolved only when the power of certainty, or yakina, comes. 7. Greed and the desire for more. This is dangerous because it causes the person to be like the moth, insensately dashing itself against the candle flame. It is countered only by austerity and piety. Eight, irresponsibility. This is manifested by the desire to attain something which has been conceived in the mind. It is always in motion, like a globe continually turning. It can be made to depart only by patience. 9. Haste to fatigue. This is lack of constancy of purpose in its usual manifestation. This is what prevents people from realizing that there is a succession of objectives which will replace present, crude ones. From this calamity, it is impossible to escape save by the establishing of the ordered thanks. Exercises are employed to overcome this tendency. 10. Negligence. Slothfulness of a deep kind is shown by lack of awareness of the needs of a situation or an individual. Alertness is cultivated through remedies applied by the physicians of the essence, the dervishes. It will be noted that ordinary, contemporary psychotherapy attempts the treatment of some of these conditions, but only in order to guide the mind into a pattern which the psychological doctrine assumes is normal. According to the dervish, the conditions which have to be treated are due to an unharmonious state of the mind, groping for balance and evolution. It is impossible from this point of view to attempt to restore a mere equilibrium without a dynamic forward movement. The psychologist tries to make a warped wheel turn smoothly. The dervish is trying to make the wheel turn in order that it may propel a carriage. The deep knowledge of the spirit, section 3 of the dervish book and placed 11th in Colonel Clark's version, involves a form of exposition where many theories meet. This chapter, when read in the light of Sufi technical terminology, shows how the progress of the human mind to realization accords with the symbols of religion. Words like angels, Adam and Eve, grace, are here used in such a manner as to show how the Sufi thinkers interpreted the religious law to give an insight in exactly what processes were symbolized by what have been widely accepted as historical or legendary tales or supernatural phenomena. Whatever the literal truth of the making of Eve from Adam's rib may be, the dervish Surawadi teaches the Sufi understanding of the event as a continuously repeated process of a mystical kind. In every person of mankind another exemplar becometh, by the union of spirit and essence, in part, transcribed from the exemplar of Adam and Eve. What is called heart is the combination of Adam and Eve, the soul and the essence. The male element comes from the universal soul. The female element comes from the universal essence. It is this essence which man, Adam, contacts within himself and brings forth in the form of Eve. Eve, being brought forth from Adam, therefore represents the special inner cognition of the true objective essence, produced by mankind from its interior resources. For explanations of this psychological kind, the result of actual experiences of a successive nature, the dervishes were considered by orthodox theologians to be apostates, discounting the literal interpretation of the scriptures. But the historical reality or the folklore version of scriptural stories are of no interest to the dervish. He has transcended the vehicle. To Adam, all names became known. All created things are the outcome of an interchange between the two principles, which are called essence and soul. By reason of active deed, of passive deed and power, of weakness, the attribute of male and female appeareth. In the soul of increase and universal essence, the custom of lovemaking became confirmed by the link of temperament. By means of marriage, the races of worlds became existing, and by the hand of the midwife of fate appeared in the apparent world. There are successive rarefications of true reality, each one appearing as absolute in its own field of perceptivity. Breath is the result of spirit, spirit of order. The angels, as other dervish teachers have stressed, are the higher developments of the mind. Some are spoken of here as being of the nature of Jamal, beauty, others of the nature of Jalal, grandeur. The doctrine of collection and dispersion, Jam and Tafrika, as expounded in this section, deals with the relationship between life in the world and life in other dimensions. The knower, the complete Sufi, is in the world, yet not of it. He is in a state of correct harmony with the continuum of which apparent existence is only a minor portion. He is aligned with the body and the non-body, as they must be represented in ordinary exposition. He understands the modalities which give rise to the belief in the existence of creation and the absolute which underlies it. Shining and concealment are the twin terms which deal with the manifestation and lack of perception of God in humanity. Shining means the breaking through of the sun of the reality of God from the clouds of humanity. The clouds are the aspect of hiddenness of this objectivity. The famous romance of Majnun, the madman, and Layla is used to allegorize the power of the shining and the inability of the traveller, or madman, to sustain the brilliance of that shining without having passed through a necessary preparation. The tribe of the madman interceded with some of the people of Layla, asking that Majnun be allowed to be illuminated with the sight of Layla's beauty. Layla's tribe replied that there was no harm in this, but Majnun hath not the power of beholding Layla's beauty. They brought the madman, and for him lifted a corner of Layla's tent. Immediately his glance fell on the fold of Layla's skirt. Senseless he fell. Illumination cannot be sustained by someone who is not ready for it. At the best, it will throw him into an ecstatic state in which he is paralyzed, as it were, and unable to consummate the contact. This is why, although dervish poets speak of being mad for love, they emphasize that this madness is the result of preview, not of genuine experience. It is recognized that genuine experience must take an active, mutual, meaningful form, not a form of useless intoxication. Inebriation mystics are those who stop short at this stage and try to reproduce the experience repetitiously or approximate them on paper or in emotional art. This is the stage at which much experimentation in mysticism becomes bogged down. Rapture, wajd, and existence, wujud, refer to two states of which the first is the prelude to the second, junaid. In rapture, the individual is immersed in a sensation which is opposite to the one which he formerly felt. He also becomes attuned to a form of cognition other than that to which he is accustomed. A person experiences this state when he is still at the stage when he is primitively linked with sensual qualities and has little understanding of any deeper perspective to them. Existence is the name given to the state of acquisition, when real existence, as opposed to simple physical existence, is perceived by the devotee. Period and moment are two concepts which are associated with a moment of perception on contact, a momentary cognition, the instrument of fashioning further states of being. Several other concepts and exercises are associated with these two. One such is the exercise of the freezing of movement, temporarily stopping ordinary associative processes. Another is the use of the pause of time and the pause of space, which enable the operation of constructive time to take place. A complete Sufi may be called a master of time, meaning master of starting and stopping, of modifying cognition. The individual who can operate in this sphere is called, by the sage Shibli, one who has escaped from being under the sway of hal, the mystical state of rapturous but generalized joy. Moment is the term given also to breath. It stands for the physical exercises connected with breathing, and also for the illustration of the fact that Sufi development is a succession, like the pulsation of breath, not a static condition or irregular motion. Thus, moment is a state in a place of stopping. Breath is a state free from stopping. Time is for the beginner. Breath is for the finisher, completer. Presence and absence, shuhud and gaibat, are terms which connote states of Sufihood, which may be quite imperceptible to the ordinary man or woman. The dervish may be present as far as the invisible world is concerned, yet absent as far as the familiar one is concerned. Sir Syed Ahmad Khan defines absence of this kind as whatever is outside our sight, like the force of gravitation. Shibli went to visit another great sage, Junaid. The wife of the latter was about to conceal herself modestly behind a screen. Junaid said, "Stay where you are. Shibli is absent." At that moment, Shibli began to weep. Junaid said, "You must now be absent, for Shibli has returned." Being absent or hidden means that the dervish is working in another dimension and appears to be absent. This is not the same as absent-mindedness, which is not itself a constructive or positive state. Junaid's wife could not see Shibli's absentness. Junaid had to perceive it. Similarly, the ordinary man denies even the possibility of such a state, because he cannot perceive it. For him, it is not only absent, but hidden, concealed, like the concealment of Shibli. Presence, of course, is another variety of absence, depending upon the point of view. Present with God is absent to men. Some dervishes alternate between this polarity, perhaps slowly, perhaps instantaneously. When the complete alchemicalization has taken place, there is no duality. They are constantly in the state of presence, and they are not hidden from either world. The methodology of the dervishes includes the use of exercises designed to produce tajrid, outward detachment, and tafrid, interior solitude. The correct balance of integration of the special faculties can be attained by outwardly abandoning the desires of this world and inwardly rejecting the compensation of the next world and of this world. This is tajrid. Tafrid is not essential to tajrid, but it is associated with it, or may be so. It involves the rejecting of the increase of deeds of himself and the concealing of their appearance by regarding on himself God's favour and bounty. This method illuminates the developmental shortcomings in ordinary religion, which focuses the attention upon the next world. This, for the dervish, is a primary stage, which has to be shed when the time of actual amal, or labour, starts. The obliteration and confirming of the slave's existence is the interpretation of the twin words ma'o, obliteration, and isbat, confirmation. This schematic representation of an aspect of dervish being is widely misunderstood by laymen. Every obliteration is a confirmation. Obliteration of undesirable or negative qualities produces the activation of equal and opposite positive qualities. Superficial conjecture has labeled this theory and its processes as a negation of the intellect or mind of the dervish. By default, because dervishes are working and not theorizing or concerned with exegesis, this label has adhered to the words. Change, or talwin, and rest, tamkin, refer to attitudes of mind and body, as well as inner conditions. Rest is the term used for the permanency of manifestation of truth. In this condition, the dervish experiences a permanent tranquility of heart, which enables him to perceive true reality, or objective fact, generally called truth. Change is the exercise and also the condition of tranquility of the heart by the pursuance of exercises of presence and absence, as already noted, and other procedures. The prayer exercises, in which the special interpretations and uses of the formulas of Islam are concentrated upon, form a great part of the rest of Colonel Clark's version of the gifts. Then come the allegorical meanings of austerity, of poverty and humility, of celibacy and marriage, trustfulness, contentment, and love. Love is the great theme which runs through the ocean of Sufi poetry and the personal teachings of the masters alike. Love is essentially the creator of states of experience, which are themselves referred to as gifts. There are two general forms of love, ordinary love and special love. Those who have not followed the developments possible in this field of the Sufis constantly confuse the one with the other in a blurring alternation which deceives their perception. Such people make, for instance, serious errors in assessment of individuals, groups, and situations. Aware of this, they generally are at pains to try to retrieve their mistakes subsequently, rationalization, and in consequence may appear absurd to those who observe them, whether initiates or otherwise. Self-deception is a symptom of this form of love, whose sincerity is not questioned. Its quality is, however, subject to fluctuations imperceptible to the individual. The comparisons between ordinary and special love are listed. A perception of baraka, impalpable beauty and grace, in the form or apparent being of a thing is a quality of ordinary love. When this becomes profound or special love, it is transmuted into the self's inclination to viewing the beauty of the essence, dat, not the form. The effect of love is shown by contrasting love which beautifies existence, ordinary love, with love which refines existence, special love. Real love, of the essential type, is not general but specific. It may observe beauty in all forms, but its attention is actually directed upon the essence, which is the only love in a final sense. A person does not love in this sense if his love is capable of distraction. This is illustrated by a tale. A man once met a beautiful woman. He revealed his love to her. She said, "Beside me is one who is more beautiful than I and more perfect in beauty. She is my sister." He looked to see this woman. And then the first one said, "Boaster, when I saw you from afar, I thought that you were a wise man. When you came near, I thought that you were a lover. Now I know that you are neither." The wisdom of the dervishes portrays a characteristic of love which is so rare as to be almost unconceived by the rest of humanity. The lover thinks greatly of even slight regard from his beloved. But of his own regard for her, he thinks little. Seen in this light, the feelings of ordinary love reflect egocentricity. Clark retains in his version a number of definitions of Sufi individuals and states which are not susceptible to simple exposition. In the 70-odd years since his book appeared, it must be admitted that the Sufi sense of varying definition in accordance with many factors has not been established in, say, English. But this is probably inevitable while dictionaries retain the assumption that brevity is possible in all definitions. A fakir, for instance, is one who is poor. He is not necessarily a zahid, which is an austere man who may or may not be poor. But a fakir may be a person who is at one time austere and at another time not. Similarly, an austere person may not be a fakir in the sense of deliberate intellectual poverty or humility. The fakir has abandoned belief in the exaggerated significance of familiar chattels. To this extent, he is good or suitable for the path. He may even abandon all idea of stages of development, of states, or even deeds. But he can do this only when he has arrived at the condition when this is possible to him, when this becomes his function, not his choice. The Sufi is superior to the fakir, because the fakir initially desires fakirhood, and the Sufi desires nothing. So a fakir may become a Sufi, in which case his fakirhood is negated, nullified. No stabilization of Sufic terms is ultimately possible, though looking at the whole of the Sufi lore and some uses of the names given to Sufis can give an impression as to how the system works. What is a dervish? The Reverend Joseph Wolfe made a perilous journey through Asia in the 19th century, seeking Stoddard and Connolly, two British officers held by the Emir of Bokhara. A former Jew and priest of the Church of England, he had the blessing of influential people in Britain. He was able to travel freely in Central Asia only because he called himself the Christian Dervish, capitalizing on the prestige of the noun. A dervish is a Sufi. In North Africa, dervish is a term of respect, denoting something less than an arif, knower or wise one, while a Sufi is looked at askance as someone engaged in mysterious processes. In England, a Sufi is thought to be a Mohammedan mystic of the pantheistic type, while a dervish is something weird, what a North African might call a Sufi. Although even kings may sign themselves fakir, the label can be embarrassing in some places. A distinguished Indian academician said, "Fakir is confused with Hindu jugglers, and worse. I regard you not as a fakir, but as a man of the path." Putting the word into a phrase helps to establish the usage. "He is a dervish" means a good, simple person, devoted to truth. "He is a fakir" means one who struggles to improve himself with humility. "He is a Sufi" means one who follows the Sufi way, also one who has attained progress in the way. The confusion arises because of several factors. Not least of these is the fact that the Sufis themselves do not use labels to denote fixed states or stages, since there is no such thing in Sufism. You can label a pound of butter, butter, but a Sufi is never entirely a dervish or a knower. His status changes in relation to the infinite gradations of truth and objectivity. In Sufi literature, the words Sufi, dervish and fakir are used more rarely than knower, lover, follower, traveller. The other words tend to be externalist labels. In Sufism, the shortcomings of dictionary definitions are exposed perhaps more strikingly than in other fields. Thus, Chambers Dictionary, 1955 edition. Dervish. A member of one of numerous Mohammedan fraternities. Sufi, a pantheistic Mohammedan mystic. Fakir, a religious, especially Mohammedan mendicant, ascetic. the meanings of the word Muhammad, or even Muhammadan, fraternity, pantheism, mystic, religion, mendicant and ascetic are different in Eastern usage, and especially in Sufi application, than in English. A Persian dictionary, perhaps more poetically, if with less seeming precision, says, "What is a Sufi? A Sufi is a Sufi," and succeeds in rhyming the entry, "Sufi chist, Sufi sufist." This is actually a Sufi quotation. The compiler does not believe in trying to define the indefinable. An Urdu one says, "Sufi refers to any one of numerous special but successively necessary stages of being, open to humanity under certain circumstances, understood correctly only by those who are in this state of work, amal, considered mysterious, inaccessible or invisible to those who have not the means of perceiving it." Clark quotes Sufi literature of most of the classic authors over a period of 700 years, from 911 to 1670. Persians, Afghans, Turkestanis, Arabs, Indians. His Western sources range from 1787 to 1881, nearly 100 years. His translation of the Gifts was published by the Government of India's Press at Calcutta. This particular work is suited to exposition outside its nominal cultural pattern, partly because it is itself the product of a school which interlaces, crossing and recrossing the traditional Sufic stream over the centuries during which the Dervish format has been familiarly overt. This interplay is important because it shows how the Sufic stream meets, blends, and recombines in a manner which superficial observation of the Dervish orders would not expect. The author of this book was Sheikh Shahabuddin Muhammad the Surawadi, a disciple of the founder of the Surawadi order of Dervishes. The order was founded on the teaching school by Ziauddin Najib Surawadi, who died in 1167. He wrote the Observances of the Disciples. His life, like that of many initiating teachers, is not well documented. This is a part of deliberate policy when the founder of a school intends to focus attention upon the school and not upon personalities. Our author, his disciple, was the chief Sufi teacher of Baghdad, a source of the concentration and transmission of the Sufic lore for his time. His disciples travelled far and wide, carrying the methodology of the order. Sayyid Nuruddin of Afghanistan, Ghazna, brought the system to India, where King Altamash made him the highest ecclesiastical dignitary of the state. Another disciple was Najmuddin Kubra, who founded his own order, the Kubravi, and who was master of all manner of miracles. He exercised, for instance, an uncanny influence even on animals, merely by means of thought projection. So many of his disciples became masters through his baraka that his title is Fashioner of Saints. Few Sufis have excelled these in their power or popularity. The Surawadi order is found throughout the Muslim world, from the Atlantic to the Pacific. In one place, a Bokhara Surawadi dervish master, Shamsuddin Hussein, made 400,000 disciples. He married the daughter of the Turkish Sultan Bayezid I, Nilufar Kanum. The great poet Sa'di of Shiraz was a disciple of our author, who was himself the nephew and successor to the founder of the order. The baraka of the order is traced to the same classical Sufi masters who provided the inspiration for the other orders and schools. Therefore, the essential character of the teaching is to be seen as coloured only slightly by its representation in an organisation known as the Surawadi Way, the last word normally translated by Westerners as order. Stemming from the same origins were the Sufi masters who considered that the Surawadiya, as it is called in Arabic, represented the correct alignment of Sufi teaching of the time, Hence there is a sort of interchangeability in membership of orders which can appear confusing. Some of the famous masters were Syeds, descendants of Muhammad. Others were direct descendants of founders of other orders, like Bahuddin Zakaria, grandson of the founder of the Qadiri order. The Grand Sheikh Jalaluddin of Tabriz was nurtured by the Surawadiya, then joined the Chishti order after 7 years with Shahabuddin at Baghdad. Sufism here is to be seen as a means of concentrating a certain teaching and passing it on, through a human vehicle, through climates prepared for its reception. Before and after Clark, this has been attempted in Europe with varying success. In most cases, the effect has been to draw the individual back to the roots of the teaching in the East, where it is still concentrated. There have been many Sufis living and working in the West, but it is only recently that the correct conditions have existed for the naturalization or reintroduction of a genuine transmission school in the Western world. The impatience of many would-be students is only faintly useful in the evolution of such a work. Among the cornerstones for this kind of development, Colonel Clark's version of the gifts is undoubtedly to be mentioned.